Hi, I'm John Mallos. Welcome to this live edition of Connect with Me on the showroom floor at Ventura TV on this Thursday morning. And we're glad that you're here. We're talking baseball today. The Fresno Grizzlies opened their season at home, the Chuck. Let's hope the weather holds up. 436 Me TV, option 11. And speaking of Chuck, the Chuck, how about Chuck Charles McGill? He's an attorney at law and has been practicing for more than 25 years. He's our sponsor on the program today. Back in a moment. Sports back here on Connect with Me on Me TV Fresno on this Thursday morning. Glad you're here. Quick programming note for tomorrow. We got George Hostetter in the house. He's a former writer for the Fresno Bee, and now he writes for the CV Observer. He'll talk about some city issues and what Mayor Lee Brand is up to and what the city council is up to. Is there a little chaos, a little tension there on the council these days? I don't know. Well, George seems to think so. You know, we had Clint Olivier yesterday, and he kind of said, no, everything is fine. What are you guys talking about? Anyway, on Monday, we have Dennis Hart. He'll be talking about what's going on with Bill O'Reilly at Fox News. He'll be talking about Donald Trump and, of course, Devin Nunes. And I'll mention Devin in just a moment because we had some breaking news on this. You're watching us live on Comcast, channel 375, as usual, Monday through Friday, live 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock in the morning. It's a call-in show, 436-ME-TV, option 11 if you want to call in. And 43.6 and 13.1 over-the-air broadcast with one of those television digital antennas. The replay, like it or not, comes up at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. 13.6 U2, 8 o'clock tonight on 4.6 Biz TV. After that, we are on YouTube. So to the breaking news, and early this morning, you may or may not have heard our own Devin Nunes, who is the chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, has now recused himself from that Russian probe into last year's election. Let's roll the videotape, show you what I'm talking about. Devin Nunes has decided to step away. When asked by CNN earlier today, Paul Ryan, the Speaker of the House, did not answer the question, did he ask Devin Nunes to step aside? Now, you might recall, CNN has been on this, as Fox News has, the New York Times. They repeatedly asked Devin Nunes the last couple of weeks, are you going to recuse yourself from the investigation into the Russian hacking, of course, of the election last year? And Nunes' response has always been, why would I? He was in Fresno on Friday. There were protests out there at Tornino's. And so he finally has decided to recuse himself. But the question is, you know, did Paul Ryan ask him to step down, or did he do this on his own? Did he finally see the light that perhaps there is a conflict of interest? He has said that a whistleblower in the White House gave him information. That's why he went into the White House to view the documents, then came out and briefed the media. However, New York Times and other news agencies have reported it was not a whistleblower. It was actually two members of the Security Council inside the White House. So if they are Security Council members inside the White House, they can't possibly be whistleblowers. So a little bit of a conflict right now. Devin has decided to step aside. We'll see what happens with the investigation, and we'll keep tabs on it. All right, back to the hand of baseball today. The opener at Chukchansey Park tonight, 7 o'clock. If you don't have your tickets, go out and get them. It should be a sellout tonight. It usually is for opening day. And, you know, they get big crowds out there on occasion. And, you know, this past year, the Grizzlies drew more than 439,000. The year before, they won the national championship under their manager, Tony DeFrancesco. He is our guest today, but I want to roll this piece of videotape so you learn a little bit more about the manager's plight. He's been in baseball all of his life. Check it out.
It's America's favorite pastime, but it's Tony DeFrancesco's life. He spent decades watching it, playing it, and now coaching it.
Yeah, professionally, this is my 33rd year in professional baseball, 9 as a player.
He was drafted out of college by the Boston Red Sox, played AAA ball for years. As a manager, he led the Sacramento River Cats to 2 championships and the Fresno Grizzlies to their AAA crown.
You know, one thing when you manage, they kind of tell you where the city is.
From Southern Oregon to Sacramento to Oklahoma City, also a stint in the majors as interim manager for the Houston Astros, and now to Fresno.
You know, I'm a lifer, right? Like you said, 30-something years in this game, and hopefully I can go another 10 or 15, just keep going.
It's a career going strong, but a major hiccup came about 3 years ago when a routine physical exam uncovered a serious concern.
I went and got a colonoscopy. Yeah. Something came back, and it definitely was cancer, and I had to get it treated.
It was early stage cancer, an opponent Tony DeFrancesco never thought he'd meet, but he faced it with a vengeance.
It's a pretty tedious radiation and chemo treatment that you go through, but you know, it was 5 weeks, and 3 weeks after that, I was in the dugout again in Oklahoma City.
No way.
And back to work for the rest of the year. Aaron, hit some fungos.
Now, 3 years after his shocking diagnosis, Tony D wants to talk about it and spread the message that cancer can strike anyone.
Even though I was an athlete and a player, it doesn't matter who it affects.
Yeah.
And you just got to keep fighting every day and stay positive.
Tony D says he's thankful for the staff at MD Anderson in Houston where he was treated, and he's thankful for life cancer-free.
There's a 5-year period that I have to continue to do this. And,
well, you're 3 years in, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that's good.
Yeah.
You're well on your way.
I am.
A baseball career that spanned decades, facing opponent after opponent and winning the battle against perhaps the toughest opponent of all, cancer.
All right, live in our studio right now is Tony DeFrancesco. He is the manager of the Fresno Grizzlies. They open up tonight at Chicchancy Park. His 33rd season overall in professional baseball. And by the way, the Grizzlies open up for the 20th time. That's right, 20 years the Grizzlies have been in the city of Fresno. I was here when they first opened up. They didn't play at the Chuck. The Chuck hadn't been built yet. They were playing out at Fresno State, Biden Field. It's amazing. They've come a long way. And you know what's going on downtown, the city of Fresno trying to build up businesses and trying to attract, you know, build major attractions so people will come downtown. So there is a major attraction tonight. There's a game. Hey, 436 MeTV, option 11. We're back with our guest and your phone calls in a moment. After this from Charles Chuck McGill.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
The following is a list of celebrities you will not see on MeTV programs. Charlie Sheen, Lindsay Lohan, Snooki, Paris Hilton, Perez Hilton, Honey Boo Boo, Justin Bieber, Simon Cowell, Chris Brown, Miley Cyrus, and the Real Housewives of any place. This is who you will see on MeTV programs. Lucy, Ralph, Mary, Perry, Gilligan, Kenneth, Spock, Batman, Rowdy, Festus, and the Beaver. MeTV. Thanks for watching.
All right, back here on the show with Tony DeFrancesco. Welcome to the program, sir. Nice to have you. It's my pleasure to meet you and have you here. It really is.
Yeah, thanks for having me. This is great, yeah.
Yeah, I appreciate it. And you know, you're so popular, you already got a phone
That's
call.
That's amazing, yeah.
All right, caller, go ahead. You're on the air with the manager of the Fresno Grizzlies. What's your question, please?
Well, there's actually 2 questions. My first one is, I had my first colonoscopy at 40, and then I had my second one at 45. I'm 50 now, so I'm kind of due for another one. My question is, you know, he's in that macho type baseball, you know, men. I have 5 brothers, including my dad, though. That's big 6. I can't get them to go and take a colonoscopy. They don't want to go through it. I mean, I went through mine, my first one. It was not pleasant. I mean, I was awake during the whole time. I told them about it. Now, I mean, they're like, heck no, that's not going to happen to me. But I tell them they need to get that because, you know, it's something they need at that age. That's my first question. And my second question is, as a manager, how much input do the owners have of the ball club as far as who plays, who doesn't play? I mean, do you ever get calls from way up, you know, like from upstairs or management saying, you know what, this is what we want in the rotation? I mean, or do you have complete control of everything? Those are my two questions.
Yeah, those are two great questions. I think the first question to the colonoscopy, I think that's, you know, that's why I'm sitting here in front of you right now, is that early detection is something that it can save you with this disease. It was, you know, very early stages. I went through the chemo and radiation. Yeah. And that's one thing I would tell your brother is that, you know, you got to go in there. The procedures today are pretty simple now. They put you out. The biggest problem probably is the prep going leading up to the day you're going to get the colonoscopy. And, you know, once you're, you know, sedated, you know, you go right through it. Most of the time it's, you know, clean scan. You're out of there. And it's just a way to breathe. The rest of the day. The second part of your question, I think, you know, this is my 23rd year managing, and early in my
minor leagues, or
I did have
you had a stint in Houston too.
Yeah, I was intern manager in 2012, and you know, just going back to my early career managing, back then, you know, there wasn't the sabermetrics as much. They kind of let you run the show. They let you do what you want, play who you wanted. But today's game, with the amount of money that's being laid out to these players and prospects and trades, they really do impact the way I manage the game now. They kind of tell me, you know, who are the prospects, who we want playing more, the playing time, the pitching rotation. So
they do tell you that. So you don't. And so, in terms of control, how much do you have, would you say?
Well, you know, once the game starts, I'm running the game. You know, we know the starting pitcher, he can go 100 pitches. Once he comes out, I already have my bullpen lined up. So there's no real say in the pitching, who I can pitch that day. With the starting, you know, nine guys on the field, you know, they won in 14 days. Some guys are going to play 10 days. Some guys are going to play 12 days. Some guys are going to play less. So it's my job to make sure that I, you know, get everybody in the game the way that they want everybody done. And now with the positioning moves, as guys playing infield and outfield, we have more versatility right now at our level. And I think that's going to, you know, help the player down the road.
Yeah, and you have coaches, too, that help you manage all of that as well. Keep track of pitches, keep track of how many innings, keep track of each player. I mean, you guys track every ball and strike, don't you?
It's pretty amazing how this
analytical
has really taken over a lot of the decision-making. On our staff, we have Aaron DeJudis. He's our analytical specialist. He gets all the information.
What does that mean? That's a fancy title. What is that?
Yeah, he kind of gets all the information that is being processed and sent over the computer. He prints out all the defensive shifts, all the opposition pitchers and hitters. Mm-hmm. And every day we have a meeting before a new series. We go over all the information. We dissect it, try to get as much information out that can help the player. We have hitters meetings, pitchers meetings, defensive meetings. This way, when we go on the field, everybody knows what's going on, and you know it's all about preparation. And then they go out and play the game at 7 o'clock.
How much preparation? How many hours do you spend?
Yeah, it's amazing. People think, you know, you just show up at 7 o'clock and the lights turn on, the game starts. You know, we're there at 12 o'clock in the afternoon. We don't leave until after midnight. With the travel in this league, you know, it's a long, grinding season. But you know, the reward is that we get these guys to the major leagues, and the Astros are off to a great start right now.
All right, caller, you're on the air with the manager of the Fresno Grizzlies. Go ahead.
Tony, I know you have a young team. You have about 14, 15 new players, young players. How do you mold them together with veterans or been there a little longer? How do you as a manager decide when you take out a pitcher and it's time for the pitcher to come out, let's say maybe after five innings because he's maybe not doing what he's supposed to do? And do the pitchers get upset when you take them out too early? That's a real good question that I want to know. As far as the young pitchers, the Astros had a good season last year, I thought. So your job is the hardest part. Your job is like 24 hours a day. You just don't go to sleep and say, I take a 3-4 hours. No, that's a 24-hour job. Mm-hmm. So I commend you. It's like listening to your wife talking all day, but you got a harder job, you know, with the ball players. So really, that's all I wanted to ask a couple of questions. Thank you, Tony.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Again, like, you know, my job is not only just, you know, make the lineup up, but there's a lot of stuff that goes on in that locker room. You know, a lot of stuff that you're talking about, we already discussed it. You know, there's pitch counts in the minor leagues as long as the major leagues. Like right now, our starting pitchers can only go 80 pitches for the first month, the month here of April, and eventually they'll get up to 100 pitches. So the innings and taking the guy out of the game early, you know, that's depending on them. But most of the time, it's about the pitch count. You know, if they're going to be in the, you know, 75 pitches after four innings, there's no real option. They know they're going to come out of the game. And you know, we're here to protect the players. You know, they're a big investment for the Houston Astros. And then the bullpen, you know, most of the time right now, early in the season, we're probably just going to go, you know, one inning at a time, let everybody get their feet wet, and eventually there'll be, you know, one or two in pitches. But, again, it's all about communication. Like any other business, you got to sit down and talk to the player, let him understand his role, let him understand what he means to the organization. Like you said, the Astros are, for me, this is going to be the year that they're going to have an opportunity to get to the playoffs. And my guys down here know that when they do get called up, that they're going to have to impact the game and, you know, contribute to winning baseball.
Hey, so just to follow up on what the caller asked, have you ever gone out to the mound and the pitcher is just like, just seething because he knows he's coming out. He knows he gave up, a double down the right field line that scored two runs, and now the game's in jeopardy. He knows he's coming out. But have you ever had any back talk from a pitcher? Have you ever had a pitcher say, hey, look, I'm not coming out. I don't want to come out.
Oh, there's been many a time, yeah.
Really?
You know, like I said, you know, forewarned is like when I go out there, you know, I don't want to hear anything at that time. If you just hand me the ball, after the game, you come in my office, I'll give you every reason why I took you out of the game. But one thing you don't want to do in this game, you don't want to show people up. And yeah. When I go to the mound and somebody flips me the ball or they say, you know, why are you taking me out? And sometimes, you know.
Has that happened before?
Oh, many a time, yeah, yeah.
What do you do in that case?
Well, sometimes I grab the guy, put him back on the mound, and hand me the ball again. Or once they get into the dugout, I take him behind the scenes and we have a few words with him. Like, this is an intense competition that's going on between me and the opposition. And, you know, my team is just part of baseball. It's a very emotional game that I don't think fans really understand, you know, the impact. It's just not like a non-contact sport. Baseball is very physical. There's a lot of demands on these players to go out there every day and compete. There's a lot of money at stake at the getting to the major leagues. You know, minimum salary is almost $550,000. So
yeah, to go to the major leagues.
So you're
a
23-year-old kid making, you know, $500,000. You're not going to make that anywhere in other businesses. So, and the potential to make more is what kind of drives these guys. So it's the competition to, you know, you can set your family up for life.
Yeah, and I'll bet oftentimes you've gone to the mound, you don't even have to answer because I know the answer. A lot of times, I'll bet you don't even have eye contact with the pitcher. Just give me the ball. Just give me the ball. You're out. Just give me the ball.
They
no eye contact. Just
usually when they're coming out,
done that, right?
You know, it's because they gave up a big hit or we didn't make a play behind them. So it's not really my fault. You didn't get the job done. So
no, but it's like no eye contact means I don't want to hear it.
Yeah, yeah. No,
just come on.
You can tell when I'm not a happy camper.
Caller, you're on the air with the manager. Go ahead.
Yeah, with all these new shows on TV that you see, how much science is there involved in football? I mean, I'm thinking science as in, I mean, I don't think the guys just go out there and hit the ball. I mean, there's some places where you want them to hit it. There's a direction. I mean, do you guys practice that or is it just me thinking that there's some kind of scientific
formula
to it? That's my question.
Okay.
Yeah, the game, like I said, the analytical part of the game has really changed. And we got a machine behind home plate. It's called TrackMan.
Oh, okay.
And this machine tracks spin rate, velocity, angle of the ball. And it's a good way to help our pitchers understand that, you know, the more spin rate you got on a baseball, the more that it spins and has backspin with lift on it. At the major league level, the guys with the highest spin rate are the people that have success. So we're trying to get our pitches.
So it's not necessarily the speed and how, you know, if you have a 92, 95 mile an hour, it's really the spin and the uplift?
Absolutely, yeah. There's a lot of outs in the upper part of the strike zone that pitchers can somehow elevate a fastball with good backspin on it, and those are getting outs at the major leagues. And it not necessarily have guys throwing 98 or 99. I mean, guys in the low 90s are getting outs. They're breaking ball. We got them have the right kind of movement, the right kind of break, the right kind of angle. And this TrackMan device has the ability to track each one of the spins and the angle of the ball. And the pitcher after the game would our analytical guy go back there and they look back at the information and they find out, you know, there's something they can do better. Offensively, now we got a new program called Blast Motion, and it's a way to check the bat angle, exit velocity, if there's any little faults in the guy's swing where they're dipping or falling and not getting the true elevation of the swing now. Because now there is a slight elevation in the swing. Back when I was playing, they used to tell you to swing down, and the backspin of the ball will carry it. But right now, you know, with the shifts, there's really not many hits on the infield. We got three guys on one side of the infield, and if you hit the ball on the ground, the percentages are you're going to make an out.
So hitters now more on the upswing than on the downswing.
That's right. They get into
even at the major league level?
Absolutely. Yeah, that's why you're seeing there's so many home runs right now, because the players are changing. There's a lot of leg kicks, and there's a lot of torque in their midsection. And then with the bat angle coming through with some lift, you know, the Astros won the last couple of games on home runs, and George Springer hit a walk-off yesterday.
Yeah,
I saw that. The day before.
Against Boston.
Marwin Gonzalez and
McCann
both hit opposite field home runs, so that's going to be a big run production.
Yeah. That wasn't against Boston. I'm thinking of Pittsburgh.
We played
and Boston.
Seattle. Yeah.
Seattle against mm-hmm. Seattle. Yeah, I saw that. So real quick, there's a split second from the time the ball leaves the pitcher's hand to the time that it arrives at home plate in the catcher's mitt.
Mm-hmm.
That's how much time the batter has to decide.
Yeah.
Are you going to swing? Are you going to back off? Or and how do you determine as a hitter if it's a screwball, if it's a slider, if it's a cutter? How does a batter decide within a split second what that pitch is?
Well, that's what I'm saying. These guys are trained for the velocity now. You know, back when I played, you know, if a guy threw 90, 92, that was a above average fastball. The major league now, there's guys throwing 98 to 100 consistently. So the back end of a bullpen, there's a lot of velocity. And young players don't know how to get started to get the right swing path for that velocity, because like you said, there's not enough time to have any extra movements. The ball's already on top of you and the bat has to dip to get to the ball. So in spring training now, we have these machines that are just pumping fastballs. The players are moving closer to the machine.
Hmm.
So they're trying to correlate 98. The only way you can do that is you have to move up in the batter's box. The machine is going to throw its 85-mile-an-hour straight fastball. But because the distance is closer, now the velocity is the same as a 98-100-mile-an-hour fastball. So now, if you're late on that in the cage, you're going to swing and miss and foul it off. Players are getting to these balls pretty easy now. They understand the timing of their mechanism to get going. And before you know it, these guys are able to hit above average fastballs. But it takes a lot of, it's hours in the batting cage that these players are in there swinging and swinging.
Yeah. All right, Tony DeFrancesco is here. He's the manager of the Fresno Grizzlies. They open up tonight, 20th season here in the city of Fresno. You can call in and ask your question at 436-ME-TV Option 11. Charles Chuck McGill is our sponsor today here on the program.
When you're looking for KitchenAid innovation and quality, who has the answers, the selection, the price? Ventura TV Appliance. With billions in nationwide appliance buying power, more than Home Depot and Best Buy combined, we'll help you save. Our low prices on Energy Star qualified KitchenAid appliances save you energy and money, and pay no interest on select models when paid in full within 12 months. Ventura TV Appliance, serving you since 1951.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
All right. That's why you play the game, right?
Right there, yeah.
That's exactly why you play the game, for celebrations like that. Of course, last year, and I got to get on you for this a little bit, you missed the playoffs.
Yeah.
What happened?
You know, we were on a good run, and then it's all about the major league team, man. Once they get hurt, then they start draining us. Then we got to fill from below, and so we had some young, inexperienced players. But I think this year with the major league team, the depth that they got up there, we should be able to keep our team together for a while and hopefully get off to a good start.
Hey, before we talk more baseball, I got to ask you, because the caller mentioned it, and that piece that we ran in the monologue mentioned you know, about the colon cancer and this and that. How did that change your outlook on life, or did it?
It's a big wake-up call. I think anytime you associate your name with the cancer, it definitely changed. Think about your family and friends, and if you're really going to have a chance to survive this thing. And I was very lucky at the time. I was with the Houston Astros. You know, MD Anderson's a big sponsor down there. I got right in right away, got the test, did the treatment within a month, and I was back at work. And
did it change you in what way?
Yeah, it makes you definitely aware of what's going on in the world. That affects a lot of people, not just myself. Now, all of a sudden, every time I turn around, talk to somebody, and somebody comes up to me and says, I had it, or a family member had it. And
you're making people aware of it.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, the Grizzlies and, you know, MD Anderson wanted me to be a spokesperson. And, you know, that's a pretty huge asking of a person. And But I do my best as many times as I can to go out there and preach the word that, you know, early detection is definitely the answer, because it's definitely curable.
Yeah. Okay. So you were the last manager to lead the Houston Astros when they were in the National League.
That's a great trivia question.
That is a trivia question.
I still
question.
Remember that day, because we lost at home the final home game. The next day was an off day. The next day we're going to Chicago Cubs to finish the season.
Yeah.
And, you know, that was the day I was told that I didn't get the job for the following year. So I remember going back into the locker room. I was like, man, it's the last time I'm going to manage here in Houston. Am I going to get the job?
Why didn't they give you the job?
Well, that's not my decision, but, you know.
What's your gut feeling?
Well, I think, you know, when I went into the locker room, my office door was closed.
Oh.
And I'm like, wow, that's kind of strange. I opened the door, and the general manager, Jeff Luhnow, was in there.
Okay.
And I already started breaking down because, you know, it was just an emotional time for me. He says, hang in there. I go, just want to let you know, you finished second. And I kind of took it as like, you know, you got two first-round picks. He's going to pick, you got to pick one or the other. And he went with the other guy, and said it wasn't his decision. But, you know, that was a tough night for me. We finished up in Chicago. At the time, the team was struggling. You know, when I got there, we wound up going 15-15 the last 30 games. And, you know, we ended on a positive note. And, you know, Altuve was on the team, Dallas Keuchel, Marwin Gonzalez. Yep. All right now impacting the major league team. So it was, a lot of good came out of it, you know. And that's just the life of baseball, man. There's a lot of disappointments from coaches as well as players.
Yeah, there is. And, you know, I want to talk a little bit about the life of not only a major league player, but specifically a minor league player. You were born in the Bronx, New York, and you came out of Seton Hall.
That's right, yeah.
You know, but you spent the majority of your career in the minor leagues. What kind of a life is that for a minor league player who doesn't make the money, say, that a major leaguer does, and then rides on, you know, buses here, there, and everywhere, doesn't get the fanfare or the fame, and it's difficult, especially for a player that's bouncing. Let's say a player gets called up for 2 weeks and goes back down, then gets called up for two more weeks and gets back. So it's so unpredictable. What kind of a life is that for a young kid?
Yeah, I mean it's
you lived it.
I was there. I was no different than any young kid, you know, watching the New York Yankees when I was a kid, saying one day I hope to be Game 7 of the World Series or playing in the major leagues. And it's just a dream. And then as you progress from high school, you know, very lucky I got drafted out of high school by the Angels.
Yeah.
I wasn't ready to go to pro ball. I had a full scholarship to Seton Hall, so I go there for 3 years, and I'm drafted by the ninth round by the Boston Red Sox. And that's when my career started as a young player, and I'm thinking, okay, I'm good enough to go to the major leagues. And, you know, it's a very difficult grind at the time, and a lot of travel, like you said, a lot of bus rides back in the day. You know, the buses were the old school buses, Bull Durham, the movie, exact how I grew up, you know.
Uh-huh.
And, You know, and then you work your way up from A-ball to AA to AAA, major league camp, thinking that, you know, one day you'll get a shot. Unfortunately for me, I got to AAA after playing 9 years in professional ball. And, you know, three years in AAA and nothing happened. And then I was very lucky just to go. The next step was going right into coaching. I was a catcher, so I became a catching instructor and hitting coach. And within a year or two, I was managing, and I've been managing for the last, you know, 20, 23 years now. So.
Yeah, yeah, and the last few for the, well, I think the last seven for the Houston Astros minor league AAA team.
Right, right.
And the last three, I think, for the Grizzlies here.
Yep.
If I'm not mistaken.
That's 14 years in the Pacific Coast League, which is, you know.
As a manager.
As a manager. So I had 7 years with Sacramento.
Right, where you won three championships in a row, by the way, in Sacramento, and then you won one here in 2015.
Yeah, so that was, I've been very lucky. Good, great players, great coaches, great organizations. You know, four championships is, you know, that's hard to do in any business. And, you know, overall, I think I got seven or eight rings throughout my, you know, my whole minor league playing and coaching career. So very fortunate with some great players. You know, hopefully this year we'll get another one. And, you know, at the end of the year, hopefully the Astros will be in a place that can all get us a bigger one.
Yeah. Caller, go ahead. You're on the air.
Yeah, I was just hearing that him being from New York City, how does he get the players and himself assimilated or you know, I mean, adjusted to this California, Central California heat? Because when I was in the military, I mean, everybody used to think that all Californians lived back near the beach. You know, yeah, the beach is right there. And they would tell me, you live by the beach. I go, no, I live in Central California. So, I mean, how do you get that used to the heat? Because I was in New York City last summer, and it was like 90 degrees, and they were talking, this is a heat wave. We're dying. And I'm like, it's 114, 100 X amount back home. You know, I mean, this is cool. You know, I mean, this is great weather.
Yeah.
I mean, how do you get the players coming from all over the nation, you know, used to this heat?
Yeah.
And how do you keep them from just saying, you know what, it's too hot, I'm going to leave? That's my question.
Yeah, that's a good one because, like I said, I grew up in New York, and when I was in high school and college, we had snow on the ground, and it was 25 degrees playing baseball. So we welcomed the heat, actually. You know, when the players are from all over the country, they're all from different, from the United States, from the Dominican Republic, from Venezuela, so they know about the heat. And I don't care where you are in the summertime, it's hot everywhere. I've been all over the country midsummer. I've been to Texas, where it's 100 degrees with humidity. I live in Arizona, and
it's hot there.
I know what 105 is like, and I know what 120
That's
is like.
That's dry heat, though.
And for me, the Central Valley here is kind of like Arizona. It's a dry heat.
Yeah.
You know, you can handle 105 when the game starts. You know, we're good at, you know, anything below 100, we can handle it. But what we do during bat, we were out there early at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. We got to make sure that the players are hydrated. We keep them off the field as much as we can. And, you know, we're ready for the 7 o'clock game. So they'll get acclimated to it. They know it's hot. Like I said, in Chicago, it's hot and humid in the middle of the summer.
Mm.
And you can go down to Florida, and it's going to be hot down there too.
Boston, it's hot. Everywhere it's hot, but the humidity is what's really bad on the East Coast and the Midwest. 436 MeTV option 11. Tony DeFrancesco is here, manager of the Fresno Grizzlies. They open up tonight at Chancy Park, 7 o'clock. Get your tickets. Still, they still have some on hand. 436 MeTV option 11. Back after this from Charles Chuck McGill.
Sports is now on KVHF 4.3.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill, Guzman, McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
Yeah. Back here on the program, Tony DeFrancesco. I want to roll a piece of videotape, and it's called A Diving Catch by Tony Kemp. This guy makes a lot of diving catches. So as we take a look at the videotape, why don't you go ahead and talk about him a little bit? He's still on the team,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, he's here. We're happy he's going to be leading off
tonight.
Hang on,
caller.
He'll be leading off tonight, and he's a pretty special player, Tony. He's very athletic. You watched his catch here.
Look at that.
You know, that's just athleticism at its best right there. He makes some great diving catches.
How tall is he? He's not very big,
He's
is
a
he?
Little guy. He's probably maybe 5'5", max.
Yeah.
But he went to Vanderbilt. Very intelligent kid. He runs well.
Is he your center fielder?
They call him a utility guy. He's going to play a lot of second base this year. He's going to go out to the outfield, run around like he did there.
Okay.
Lead off for us. He can run, steal a bag. Like a high-energy guy. And once he's locked in, he definitely can carry a team.
Why hasn't he made it to the big club?
Well, he had a chance to go up last year for the first time. You know, he's very excited. You know, one thing with our team right now, like, you know, we got Jose Altuve, who's Silver Slugger Award. We got Carlos Correa. We got Alex Bregman. We signed a Cuban first baseman, Gurriel. There's really not a lot of room unless there's an injury. And these young players here in AAA got to understand that now's the time to prepare themselves that when they do get called up and they do get an opportunity, that they can impact the game. There's no more trial and error. When I was in the big leagues in 12 as the manager, we had a very young team. And whether they did well or not, they were getting an opportunity to play in the major leagues. And right now, the guys that are going up, it's, you know, you really got to produce or we'll find somebody else right now. So there's a lot of pressure on these young kids to perform.
See, here's the thing. I'll get to you in a minute, caller. Here's the thing about being a minor leaguer, and I've thought about this. I played some baseball, not at your level, but obviously I wasn't good enough. But to me, I'm looking at some of these players, and they prepare every day, mentally, physically. They give it 110%, if you can say that,
mm-hmm.
and they're prepared for the big call to the big club, to the major leagues, the big show, they call it. Okay, and what if that call never comes? That's the frustration, yeah. I guess, huh? That's the chance they have to take.
Well, I took the chance, you know, like I said, 9 years of my life. But one thing,
how do you talk to the young players about that? Because you lived it, you went through it. Do you ever talk to some of these guys? Look, you may never get the call, but
yeah.
Do you ever have that talk with them?
I really don't. Like, you know, I don't want to put a damper on anybody's dream. Like, you know, you're going to make it. And if it's not with the Houston Astros, there's 29 other teams that you're playing for. So you fight every day to survive this thing. Like, you know, there's times where, you know, you get beat up pretty good in baseball. Like, slumps happen and you're 0-20. There's no hope. You don't even want to come through the locker room door like you're fighting the demons. And then it's such frustration, and you got your girlfriend or your wife and your kids, and you're like, how much longer are we going to be moving around the country?
Yeah.
And before you know it, man, it's my job to, hey, it's going to be all right. The sun's going to come out. You're going to get out of this thing. But that's the manager, like, you know, that I feel I am. Like, I can sit down and talk to a player and say, look, man, you know, times are tough, but you fight through it. Because I have every reason in my whole storybook. You know, the disappointments that I had over the years, and that's just part of being in this game.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You've lived it. You've been through it. You've been through those disappointments and not being called up to the big show, not managing in the major leagues as well. So you have some insight that a lot of people don't have.
Right,
but,
right.
Yeah. Okay, caller, you're on the air with the manager of the Grizzlies. Go ahead.
Now, Tony, let me ask a direct question to you.
Ara.
Do you ever plan to be an assistant in the majors, or is it maybe not in the future? I look at you right now. I mean, you've been there 23 years managing, and you still look young, you know? I mean, you look like you're fit, and my life, you could manage another 30 years.
I'm ready, yeah.
But what I always see is it's like San Francisco. For some reason, even a player that's not all the way to the top level, they produce and they enjoy themselves. Now, that's your job to make sure that they enjoy themselves. But Boshi is, you know, he's one of the few that can get a player to play to his highest level and get the most out of them. And I hope you do that with your club, because I just watching you, man, I hope that someday that you get up as an assistant or whatever in a managing position, because you've got a lot to give. I mean, you can settle down some of these players. So That's really what I want to ask you, Tony, and good luck for the season.
Yeah, I appreciate that. That's a great comment.
Like you said, my dream was as a player, I didn't make it. And then all of a sudden I said, okay, if I'm not going to make it as a player, I'm going to make it as a coach. And in 2008, I coached third base for the Oakland A's for the whole year.
Yeah.
And then after that, I said, okay, if I'm not going to make it as a coach, I want to make it as a manager. I enjoyed managing, and my dream came true as a manager. Now, how to get back there? You know, sometimes it's not in your hands. It's up to the major league manager to decide if I'm a good fit at the time. You know, you're looking for a catching guy, infield guy. You know, every one of those coaches has a major responsibility to that team, and you got to make sure that you got every department covered. So hopefully eventually it'll happen. You know, there's other routes that you can take in this game. You can go into the front office. You can go into scouting. You can go into player development off the field. But, you know, my passion is on the field with the players, and I think, you know, managing is something that gets me through each day.
Yeah, okay. Caller, you're on the air with Tony DeFrancesco. Go ahead. What's your question?
Yes, I had a question regarding the style of play between Major League ball and minor league ball, whereas in the Major Leagues, they do a lot of scouting on players for shifts. And I've noticed that the minor leagues, they do a lot of shifting too, player shifts. Do you do more scouting on the minor league players also with shifts? And who's the top prospect that you're looking to come up from double A right now to come to, maybe not right now, but maybe a double A prospect that we could see in the season this year? And,
yeah.
And who do you think is going to be one of the top, like the next Correa coming out of Fresno? Thank you.
Okay, yeah. Good call.
Yeah, the next Correa, that guy's hard to find right now. He's a very special player. I'm thinking of J.D. Davis. He's a third baseman down there, had a great spring training. There's a Ramon Laureano, an outfielder down there, one of our top prospects. What's happening with the Astros now, all the top players are up here in Fresno or in the major leagues. And there's a handful down in the double A and a few down below. So this is the time of the year that we're going to find out if these guys are going to be major league players. And if they can't play for the Astros, hopefully down the road we can they might get a chance with another organization. You trade a couple of these guys for a top-notch pitcher. And that's kind of the way the business is going.
So I take it that the Houston Astros are in good shape with their farm system. They got the Grizzlies, AAA system, and then they got AA. Are they in good shape as far as breeding players that are going to come up through the organization?
Absolutely. Yeah, I think what happens is
a lot of teams don't have good farm systems.
Yeah, no. But right now our top players are at the upper levels. So the lower levels, we'll need to find out. There's a guy named Kyle Tucker, Preston's younger brother, who was number one pick for us. Good-looking player, kind of looks like, you know, almost like a Ted Williams-style, big, tall, skinny kid right now. But once he projects into a major league player, he definitely can hit 25, 30 home runs and impact the game.
Mm-hmm.
So there are definitely a bunch of guys down there. You know, when I'm in major league camp, most of the time I just see the AAA guys, AA guys, major league guys. But the young players, that, you know, we're talking in reports that, you know, hopefully these are the guys that are the future of the Astros.
How do you get the best out of your players as a manager?
Yeah, it's hard to say. Every team is different. That's what I love about the game. You know, every year you get 25 guys. You get a few guys back. You get a bunch of new guys, guys from outside the organization. And for me, my number one thing, I want these players to have fun. I want them to come to the park ready to work, to love the game, love their teammates. And team chemistry, people say, is not important. But for me, that's all it is in AAA. You keep these guys focused. There's a lot of pouting going on early, a lot of disappointment. But, you know, we can keep these guys on pace to, you know, go out there and play for each other, play for the city of Fresno. You know, we had a great memory here in 15. Let's try to bring another one back to the city.
Yeah. Caller? Okay, go ahead. You're on the air with Tony.
Tony, there. One is, I know the parent team makes the decisions as to who gets called up from AAA to the majors, but who makes the decisions as to who gets called up and sent down in the minor league system, and how much say do you have in those
types of decisions in the minor league that get called up to your team and vice versa. And another question is, do the Astros, I mean, not the Dodgers, have a Mexican league down there? They host a team down in Mexico.
Yeah.
Does the Astros do that also with their AAA team to send them down there to maybe hone their skills and somewhat down in Mexico during the winter?
Okay, thank you.
Well, the first part of the question, do I have any say in players coming and going? And absolutely, I do. You know, we talk about who the players that we need. Mm. If I'm looking for a pitcher, you know, what kind of pitcher you're looking for in AA. But as an organization, they most of the time when it's time to move a guy, they'll decide it's time to move him because of age or how he's doing or time to promote a guy. And then he'll just show up in AAA, and we have to make a moves to keep the roster at 25 guys. So, you know, there's definitely a lot of communication going on with me and AJ, the major league manager, what he's looking for, who's hot. This is what's going on. Who do you got to help me, late in the game? Who's one of the starters that can fill in if they're struggling? But there's definitely some communication. Jeff Luhnow, the GM, kind of oversees all the player movement, all the drafts. So he really has a lot on his plate himself.
So tell me, is it daily communication between you and the Astros manager?
No, we talk at least once a week, twice a week. Okay. You know, yesterday the game started going into the 13th inning.
Yeah.
So that definitely could affect opening day for us. If they would have won 15, 16 innings, you know, before I even got on the field today, I would have had a player move. You know, one of our relievers going up to the big leagues to help them out because they're going to be short for the next couple of games.
That didn't happen, though.
It didn't happen. Luckily, you know, we got the win. Springer hit the home run in the 13th inning.
Yeah.
They're covered for the bullpen tonight. They used one of their guys, Davinsky, for four innings yesterday. They used their long reliever, Peacock. So, you know, we're looking at the box scores every day. We're looking at watching the games to make sure, you know, if there is a need, we can fill our need as we move a player.
All right, I want to roll a videotape called Colin McHugh. He is going to be your starting pitcher tonight, but he is here on a rehab assignment. Talk a little bit about Colin McHugh. Here he is right here. I believe he had 11 or 12 strikeouts in this game from a year ago. He's a guy that's a strikeout pitcher. He's got that capability. There's no question about that. But he's here on a rehab assignment for how long? Do you know?
Well, right now, just talking about Colin, I mean, it's a great story. He was another guy who was grinding in the minor leagues. I seen him pitch in Vegas. He went up to the Mets and struggled.
Mm-hmm.
We claimed him a couple of years ago. He pitched for me in Oklahoma City. And Colin has this unbelievable makeup of, you know, has a great breaking ball. He has, we talk about his fastball that has some elevation on it that can get strikeouts. When Dallas Keuchel won the Cy Young a couple of years ago, this kid had almost 18 wins in the major league, so he's definitely one of our top pitchers. You know, his shoulder was probably a little bit weak this spring training, so he's a little bit behind everybody, but he's ready to go. He's probably going to throw 100 pitches for us today.
Oh, he is?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then if, he feels good, that's their call in the major leagues, but if not, he'll pitch again in Vegas for us.
Now, you said he's going to pitch 100 pitches. Is that your decision, or would that be the major league
Yeah,
club?
Definitely. It's the trainer up there. It's the pitching coach, Brett Strom. It's AJ. They're definitely going to give me a number. I'm just going by. He threw 82 pitches in a simulated game back in spring training, so we're hoping, you know, 82, he can probably go up another 15 pitches.
Yeah, this is his 10th professional season. I think he spent 4 or 5 years in the majors. Mets, Rockies, Astros. And so is one of his biggest strengths is what? Obviously, he's got the capability of striking people out. It's not the first time he struck out 11 or 12 batters, as you see in this game here.
Mm-hmm.
What's his best pitch? Is it a cutter, slider, fastball? What is it?
Well, no doubt it's his curveball. He has a curveball, the old Uncle Charlie, they used to call it, 12-6 breaking ball. It kind of comes out of his hand high, and the players kind of, they give up on it, the batter, and before you know it, drops right in for a strike. He got an elevated fastball.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, he's not overpowering. He's not a guy that throws, you know, upper 90s. He's probably, you know, his low 90s at best, but definitely a guy that can command the fastball and
But he's striking guys out based on that curveball, huh?
No doubt. I think the curveball is something that if you come out to the game tonight, you'll watch him get a lot of hitters out with the breaking ball.
100 pitches, he could go 7 innings.
That'd be great. Yeah, that'll save our bullpen. And, you know, who knows, with the weather coming in, we might have a doubleheader coming real quick.
Yeah, I got to go to break, but just quickly, if a pitcher in the major leagues doesn't have a curveball or a slider, can he survive?
Yeah, you know, our hitters today can hit a fastball, and they want to hit the fastball. The pitch they don't want to hit is when they're behind the count, is something spinning. and moving away from them.
Yeah.
And you'll find out most of the strikeouts are on something off speed, a ball moving away. The only way they do hit it is when the pitcher makes a mistake. They hang it or they leave it up over the plate. Springer's home run was a 3-2 breaking ball yesterday to end the game. That was right over the middle of the plate. So, but they're looking for a fastball to hit.
Well, here's the thing. I was watching three different games last night. I was watching the Giants game. I was watching the A's game, part of the Houston game, and part of the Boston game. And one of the things I noticed is that, especially in the Giants game, there were two, three hitters. Brandon Belt, I think, was one of them. How these batters, I'm not singling out Brandon Belt, but I see it oftentimes. The pitcher will throw whatever, if it's a slider, a cutter, and the ball's in the dirt, and the batter will chase it time and time again. And I'm sitting there, and of course, in my own living room, the comfort of my own house, and I'm saying, what are you doing? What are you swinging at?
Yeah.
So why does that happen? I guess are they misjudging the pitch is, or what? It's totally out of the strike zone.
That's
what happens.
Are swing and miss pitches that the pitcher is trying to get the guy to swing at. But what happens when you're
changing. It's a cat and mouse game.
Yeah,
huh?
When you're changing speeds. And you got somebody throwing 95 to 98 miles an hour, the hitter has to be geared for that swing.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, something's spinning. He's already committed to that fastball, but it's not a fastball. And there's no way to stop the swing. And that's why you're watching guys chase balls out of the zone, because it's too hard now with the velocity and the speed change from 98 to 87. That's a huge difference for a hitter to make that kind of adjustment.
And
on the fly. So that's why it's... They do all these drills to recognize pitches, to see spin rate, to see the way the angle of the ball, to see arm slots, the way it's going to be fastball or breaking ball. There's a lot of film and technology that's going behind the scenes.
Yeah.
As a viewer, you're going, what is he doing? But it's very difficult to hit that baseball.
Yeah, one of the players that really reads these pitches so well is Joe Panik. I was watching Panik last night, and he lays off those. I mean, he has a great, I guess they call it a great eye in baseball. He's got a great eye.
Yeah, that was, I came up in the Moneyball era.
Yeah.
With the Oakland A's. And Sandy Alderson and Billy Bean.
Yep.
It was high on-base percentage was the number one thing that we tried to preach to these players.
Yeah.
And the only way you do that, like you said, you got to see pitches.
Yeah.
If you're swinging early and getting early outs, you're not developing. So we want our guys over the course of the year to see thousands of pitches. So get deep into the count. Recognize fastball. Recognize breaking ball. Recognize changeup. And, down the road, it's going to help you when you get to the major leagues to give the guy a quality at bat.
Of course, some guys do that better than others. Hey, we got about 5 minutes left. Roll the videotape on, pick any one of these. Grizzlies 2015 or Grizzlies action. You can look at some baseball action here. Tell me some of the top players you have on your team that are going to watch for tonight and maybe the rest of the season.
The first baseman, A.J. Reed, big kid out of Kentucky. Got to the big leagues last year. No doubt 25 to 40 home runs in the major leagues. Big left-handed bat. Second base, Kemp. Reed Brignac, a guy who's been a journeyman. This is a 7-team right now. Got about 4 or 5 years in the big leagues. Going to do a nice job at short. Colin Moran at the University of North Carolina. Another guy that's starting to come into his own. He got showing some more power for a corner position.
Yep.
Preston Tucker, who's been in the big leagues, coming off an injury. Teoscar Hernandez, a center fielder, a young prospect with us, definitely can hit 20, 25 home runs here. And a center fielder named Fisher, who is a plus runner from Virginia. Speed, has some power, had a great spring training, over 10 stolen bases in spring training, hit over 300. So it's a great group of guys. I think pitching, James Hoyt, Brady Rogers, who was the number one pitcher in the league last year, coming back. James Hoyt had a 29 saves last year with a 1 ERA. So we definitely got a nice crew of veterans out there. Now hopefully we get some chemistry to go out there and just have a lot of fun.
Yeah, and of course there's the mascot, of course, for the Fresno Grizzlies. And so when people go out there to the Grizzly games, they're looking at players that are giving it their all, 100%, because they know what's at stake. Am I right about that?
No doubt. These guys... They're gonna get a great effort from these players. It's a very intense game. The one thing with Fresno, it's been giant country for years. This is their third year. We're hoping that fans that come out now are gonna watch these players go to Houston, when they come out and play Oakland and Anaheim and on the West Coast, they get a chance to watch some of these young players perform at the major league level, just like Bregman was here, and so was Correa came through here. So it's going to be a nice group of guys they're going to get to watch.
Yeah. All right, Tony, just a couple of final things here. We got a couple of minutes left before we got to go here. We got to get out at the top of the hour. But 436 MeTV, option 11, got time for one quick phone call if you want to call in. Why is opening night so special around the country? I mean, obviously the major league season started last weekend, last Sunday. In the minor leagues, it starts a little bit later. Why is opening night so special?
It seems for years it's always been special. I mean, I go out there with butterflies first day, just like I was a young kid going in my first game. The players are nervous. They're anxious about the season to start. And then for some reason, once this game ends tonight, the flow of the season just starts tomorrow. It's pretty amazing how players just kind of relax. Today's a big deal. We'll be doing the lineups and national anthem and probably flyover. And it's a great time for us to enjoy the sport that's been around for a long time.
Yeah, and then tomorrow you kind of settle in.
You settle in tomorrow, yeah.
Hey, Tony, good to meet you.
Yeah, nice meeting you.
Hey, come back again. Love to have you as a guest.
Yeah, when we win a championship, we'll come back again.
You got it. Yeah. All right, my pleasure. All right, Tony DeFrancesco, good luck to you for the season here in 2017 with the Fresno Grizzlies. They open up tonight at Chukchansey Park, 7 o'clock. We will see you tomorrow on Connect With Me with George Hostetter, formerly of the Fresno Bee, now with a CB Observer, talking about city politics. Who knows? We might even talk about the Grizzlies on tomorrow's program. See you then. Have a good day.
If you have a need to promote your business or event, please consider MeTV Fresno for your next campaign. MeTV reaches over 100,000 of your potential customers in the Fresno area every single week. Plus, you can rest assured that your commercial is running in the greatest family-friendly programs of all time. MeTV Fresno delivers a strong, loyal audience ready to buy, and your campaign will cost a fraction of what you're paying for your advertising now. Call me today to find out how affordable MeTV is at 905-1925.
Have you or a loved one recently been arrested for a serious crime?
Is your professional reputation at risk?
Aggressive representation from a qualified defense attorney can help you avoid conviction and keep your reputation untarnished.
Hi, I'm Charles McGill, and I'll fight for your rights. With extensive experience in successfully defending against a wide range of criminal offenses and high-profile cases, you can rest assured that you'll get the fair trial you deserve from McGill Guzman McGill. Call us at 559-255-3425 or visit us online at toplawyersfresno.com.
Tune in to Heartland for the best in true country music. Relive vintage specials, one-of-a-kind concerts, and country music's earliest videos. Heartland is the heart of country, the only place where you can find country music, country stars, and country lifestyles 24/7. Heartland, the heart of country.
Now on channel 13.2.